thank you so much for coming, and especially thank you so much for staying for the third talk. I'm about to give you a little medium-sized, rather intro about accessible web applications and what I learned about that over the past year. Let me introduce myself. I'm a philanthropic developer and trying to be an accessibility consultant. And I'm one of the co-organizers of this very meetup, actually, although Rainer US is the main board. And you can find and reach me on Twitter under this channel and generically online at marcos.io. So let's start. As I said, this presentation will be a short ride through typical web app specifics and their accessibility pitfalls. And unsurprisingly, my first thesis of sorts is that creative web apps should have accessibility in mind when they are building their apps. And now you're maybe asking, how can they have accessibility in mind at first? How can they improve the accessibility of their web apps at first with getting the basics right? And this is the part where I'm referring to Priyanka, because she has established their checklist and has said all the important things. So this is taking care of the web part of the world of web apps. Sadly, most of the digital products of their app have problems with these basics alone. So this, for example, is a statistic, the so-called Verbane Union. Verbane is an NGO, and this NGO conducted automatic accessibility tests against critical failures on 1 billion websites or homepages rather, and here's what they found. It's an issue of low contrast. It's an issue of alternative text, or the lack of alternative text rather. It's an issue of labeling, both labeling forms and labeling links. And like also said before, you have to set your document language, otherwise screen readers try to read it in the default language and it's not going to work in an optimal way. So please make sure that you use the name attribute on your HTML element, therefore on your document. And the last thing is accessible labels, in this case empty boxes. So these accessibility basics make them disappear because Bianca has said all the important parts about it. It's color contrast, it's page titles, it's semantics, it's a proper document outline, it's bypass clause, it's accessible name and meaningful labeling, it's visible focus, it's the proper use of landmark regions, and it's once again the document language. Also, it's providing multiple ways. And there are many topics more that wouldn't have fit it onto this slide. So, relying on the Yacht checklist would be the best advice. And if you really don't know where to start, start here at w3.org. They got plenty of really great tutorials regarding how to build your web document, be it a web app or a classic web page in airports, how to make it much more accessible than it is right now. It's also a good starting point about learning about web accessibility. One little side before I move on, talking about web apps, is screen readers. Actually, you had this kind of the screen reader experience in the talk before. This is good, but let's take a step back and think about it in a more theoretical way. What do screen readers do? They read out the documents, if not start from top to bottom, with reading out, I mean, reading out auditory in an auditory way or via play. Either way, it's reading out some sounds. Although the contents are being read out from top to bottom, nobody uses it that way. People navigate via headlines, via links, forms, tables, landmark regions, anything. So make sure to cover the basics we have talked about. Make sure that you give screen readers and everyone else and search engines and so on structured data, a proper document outline, and yes, just like I said, document outline is so very important. Also, need for link text. And especially when it comes to web applications, labeling and structuring forms and their corresponding inputs is very important. That's it for the little side of screen readers. Now for the meat, so to speak, of this very presentation, it's about web app characteristics. What makes an a web app? So it's about the second part of web apps, the app part. Now, what's an app actually? Turns out it's rather hard to define what a web app is or an app is. Here's Wikipedia's take on defining what a web app is. The general distinction is unclear. Websites most likely to be referred to web applications are those which have similar functionality to a desktop software application or a mobile app. The important part is that web apps try to emulate desktop, let's call it native apps. How do they do this? What are the characteristics of web apps actually? And what are the characteristics of app? Be it native, or be it on the web, or be it somewhere else socially. It's general, let's call it snappiness, reactiveness. You interact and something happens in an instant. So in terms of web app, that means loading content asynchronously. Also, when you are inputting data, it's submitting content asynchronously. Upward. I would call it AJAX from this point on, I guess. And besides from loading and submitting content asynchronously, besides from a web app being a very dynamic thing, web apps often have custom elements and often have custom widgets or custom inputs for inputting or outputting data sometimes, but let's try to concentrate on inputting data. And speaking very generically, oftentimes web apps have only dialogue on windows, which could be an accessibility issue as well. Also, Bianca had a very good example when it comes to models, but more on that later. So, how do web app authors tackle these challenges? We have two general toolboxes on how to tackle these things. The first one being messing with the focus, programmatically changing focus. You have to do this very responsibly, but it could be a measure in order to increase your UX responsibility. The other thing, and this is very generic, using ARIA roles saves the properties, also very responsibly. These rather two toolboxes together could help you in solving the problem that in web app is rather dynamic and screen reader accepts, so to say, a rather static document. A document that goes from top to bottom. And in the following, I will try to present some methods in how to remedy these problems and in how to use, for example, changing focus and use ARIA or concepts of ARIA or tools of ARIA or roles in order to improve accessibility, in order to remedy this dynamic nature. The first one is notifications. You have to actually tell, let's say, screen readers about things that are going on your site in a dynamic way. And the first, or the most important tool for this are ARIA Live regions. Now, what are ARIA Live regions? At first, what is their purpose? Their purpose is to announce state changes. Now, state changes, kind of what is the state change? I don't know. If you using some Google Doc, Google Spreadsheet documents, and you got autosave enabled, the state change could be that when visual users will get a notification that this very document is autosaved, screen reader users should get a notification as well. Live regions give you the opportunity to announce state changes, announce things that are happening in your web app without the screen reader user actively searching for content that has changed, and also having to remember what content or how the content was before. So with notifications, you avoid moving focus, and you avoid reloading the page. Reloading the page is another thing that most of applications do. Quite the opposite, rather. It's actually okay. You are on one single document, and everything inside it is JavaScript. Everything inside it is dynamic. You get a virtual DOM, you change your virtual DOM, and its properties. This is rather difficult for screen readers, as I said, but luckily you get accessible notifications in forms of ARIA Live. And there are two rough types of accessible notifications with ARIA Live. The first one is assertive. Assertive is very aggressive, very brutal, and interrupting the screen reader, and it's best suitable for critical errors, for example. When you just try to inform the user about something that has happened, that they changed location, that something got saved, for example, you should use actually ARIA Live equals polite. Now, enough of theory, here's a code example for this. This code example consists of three parts. And yes, it's okay. And the first part being the live region itself. It's, as you see, a generic container. In this case, it is. It could be something else. And now here's the attribute, and here's a button which should change the contents of this very generic container. And how do you change content in the web app? With JavaScript, of course. So here's a very dumbed-down example of what could happen. There's no business logic here, as you see, but I hope it gets to the point. So you click on your save button here, and the notice element, this one, will be filled with the text content. And the thing about array life functions is that screen readers kind of observe the contents of life functions. That meaning that once you change the content inside the life function, this is the trigger that the life function will be read out politely or assertively, depending on your setting, depending on the author's intention, of course. And the next slide is a concrete example of this. It's some generic single page application, and what you should look out for is this product count and these buttons.
You are currently on the inside to input. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Subtract out 1. You are currently on the inside of 92. To input this button, press Control Option Space. To enter this method area, press Control Option Shift Up Arrow. 6, 5, 4, 3.
This sounded funny, but it's got the point. The black border is the virtual color of the screen reader. As you might have seen, the virtual color was either on the edge button or on the subtract button, not on the counter, not on the on this very number. But still, this very number was. The counter number was read out, although your focus, your virtual cursor was on the interactive button in this case. Next slide instead of. Yeah, we are currently on the next slide. Once again. There are two types of accessible notifications, and there are different ways to describe them. One equivalent to array life could be role status or role log. One equivalent to role array life assertive could be role alert, which is quite fitting. This is it for accessible notifications. The next topic is about routing. And a very single page application heavy topic in this case. Let's go again back to usual screen reader behavior, especially when it comes in the context of navigation. So, at first, a user navigates to a link. That is its virtual cursor on the link. Then they click it or somehow interact with it. If this link leads to a new page, this new page gets loaded. And once finished, the screen does start new. This also means that the user of that application, or in this case, of that web document, knows, okay, my link interaction worked actually on the page intended to be. Now, for single page applications, it's a bit different, and beware of the funny. What's again? Sorry.
To click this link, press Control Option Space.
very hard to understand, I'm afraid. But the thing was, you are dedicating, this is a single page, although you might have seen that content gets finished, but you are just within the navigation, you get information about links and how to click them and so on, but you don't get any notification that you actually are on the product page or on the contact page. So it's very hard for screen readers, because they have to actively search, they have to leave the navigation, and they have to actively search for the content, and this isn't feasible at all. Anyway, this concept of switching, of changing both the location and also switching certain parts of content, it's called routing. And routing is actually an accessibility issue when it comes to assistive technologies like Google, for example. How can we remedy this? One idea is to, after you have successfully arrived at the new, it's not a new page, but the new web state, which is a route, you could send a notification with, I don't know, Aria Life, Polite in this case, about what has just happened, about page has loaded. It's better than nothing. The other way, the other alternative could be that you grab the focus and set it to the new content which has just loaded. And if you are familiar with JavaScript frameworks, you know about some concept like lifecycles. So that you can actually hook into that very moment the new component, the new content, in a generic way, has loaded and is on the site. So the best thing would be to connect either the notification or the moving of focus to this very moment. Don't send focus to a then empty container, and don't say, okay, about page is loaded, where it hasn't yet. So do this also responsibly. Also, one word of warning about moving focus is usually it's a very bad idea. This is one of the rare exceptions to the rule, because it actually adds some value. The other thing is that you have to make sure that the element is actually there. Just what I said before, use a lifecycle method of your framework if you're using one. At least use a set time off for a certain period of time. But if you got lifecycle methods, use them. They are there for a reason. And if you try to focus something, let's say a headline of the new content, in this box scenario, it could be a headline for the about. Beware that normally, usually, you can only focus interactive elements, and a headline, of course, is not interactive. So you should make it interactive by adding tab index minus one means that you can tap on it by accident, but that you can set focus programmatically with this very example.